Before you ask me any question, can I request you one thing?
Yes, please.
Don't call me Sawyer. It actually shows out to people that I'm really old.
Okay.
So I still want people to know I'm young, so let's just keep it, you know, high security.
Definitely. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome on the show, DJ Suketu. Hi Suketu, how are you? Great. So let's begin with how your music journey started. How long has it been that you have been involved with music?
I was always interested in music, okay, right from the beginning, and I knew I wanted to do something with music, but it just wasn't DJing. So from the age of about 11 to 15 or 12 to 16, I learned the tabla, mm-hmm, and I was always aspiring to be a tabla like Ustad Zakir Hussain. I'm sorry, a tabla player like Ustad Zakir Hussain, and you know, somebody like that of that level. I did a lot of performances as well with singers like Sonu Nigam before he became the Sonu Nigam right now, and Roop Kumar Rathod, etc. Then I passed out with my 10th. I got into HR, College of Commerce and Economics in Mumbai, and when I went to college, I was on the Students Council.
Yeah.
Landed up being one of the organizers for the farewell party for the TY BCom students.
Wow.
And DJ Hussain came that time to perform at the college for that party. And I was put in charge to actually look after him and make sure he got what he wanted, you know, and he was okay to with everything. So when I was with him, just talking to him, interacting with him, and then watching him perform and just watching the people go crazy on the dance floor, and I just said, why don't I give this a shot, you know, in college. Yeah. And I had a pretty good music collection. One thing led to another and I became a DJ.
How did your parents react to it when you told them that you wanted to be a DJ?
So the good thing is that my parents had no problem at all. Actually, my father is a businessman, and he had a business which my elder brother took up, and we are three brothers.
Okay.
So my dad always actually told, you know, all of us that my business is big enough to actually make one son's life absolutely fantastic. But once all you guys get married and everything, you're going to have your own family. So either you'll double the business or find something else that you want to do.
That's
so when they found out that I had an interest in music, they of course promoted me to learn the tabla very well and got me some of the best teachers at that time to teach me. And when I told them that I wanted to get into DJing and just try my hand out at it, my parents were very, very supportive. There was no problem whatsoever.
Yeah.
And I think they even trusted me for the fact that if there was anything bad that goes with the profession, I would probably stay away from it.
Yeah.
So that gave me the confidence that if they trust me so much, I should try to do my best and, you know, excel in it.
Wow, that's such a beautiful thought. What do you think is the one best thing about being the DJ?
You know, people actually think that, oh, if I become the president, I'll have the world at my fingertips, or if I become the prime minister, I'll have the country at my fingertips.
Right.
I can say you don't need to do all that stuff. You can just become a DJ when you're playing at a club. The crowd is on your fingertips already. Whatever you play, whatever you spin, they're just dancing to that.
Wow.
So yeah, I think one of the best things is actually being up there in the console and watching people down there just let themselves go.
Wow.
I mean, they might have had a bad day or a good day or whatever it is, but when they are in that moment, because of your music, you know, they've forgotten everything and they're just living that moment and enjoying themselves. So I think that's one of the best things about being a DJ.
Great. What has been the biggest learning experience for you?
Well, I think the biggest learning experience which has been for me is that every time I reached a particular point in my career, I thought, okay, I think this is it.
Yeah.
But it always opened the door to something else.
Right.
So when I first started DJing, my only aim was that I want to do so many parties a month.
Yeah.
Then once that happened, I just said, I want to now start playing in nightclubs.
Right.
Then that happened.
Yeah.
Then after that, the DJ championships came down to India, and I said, oh, I want to win that.
Wow.
And then I won that.
Yeah.
And then I said, oh, I want to be like this DJ who's making these remixes and have my own album. And I went and did that. So I feel that one lesson that I learned is that there's never an end to it.
Right.
It's just that you have to keep looking forward to the next step all the time. So even today, if somebody tells me that, oh, you've been DJing since 21 years, so I think you're pretty done, I said, why?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, there's a lot more to go. Maybe not in terms of remixes, but something else.
Sure. Right.
So one thing that I've learned is that it's never done.
Yeah, like how they say success is not a destination.
It's
a journey.
Yes, absolutely.
How did your friends react to when you started mixing and producing music first?
My friends loved me.
Yeah.
Because they could come with me for the parties and check out the women and, you know, just hit on them or whatever. So they loved me. But they never took me seriously that after college. They just thought that it was just one thing in college that I was doing for maybe extra pocket money or something like that.
Right.
But they never really took it thought of it that I would actually go all the way and make a career out of it.
Right.
So at that time, I would say that they were not supportive with the fact that I would this would be a long-term career.
Mm.
But they were supportive of the fact because they could come to places and party with me free of charge.
Nice. So is there any dream destination where you would want to perform for the audience, be it live or, you know?
So I have definitely played quite a bit around the world.
Right.
I've always aspired to play at beach parties.
Okay.
Unfortunately, I haven't got that opportunity yet.
Okay.
So even when I played in Goa, it's never been at a shack on the beach and actually going crazy. It's always been in a nightclub.
Oh, okay.
So,
yeah.
It's always, and even if I've traveled anywhere abroad for any of the tours, either to the US or to Australia, Africa,
right,
or the Far East, anywhere,
yeah,
it's always been a party in a nightclub or in a, you know, a concert hall or something like that.
Right.
So I would really love an opportunity, you know, to actually be on the beach and playing over there,
yeah,
like Fatboy Slim did.
Wow.
And,
yeah,
you know, got a crowd, which is the highest recorded crowd in history, to come for a party.
Yeah, nice.
So, yeah.
So all the sponsors in India and all over the world who are watching this interview right now, so please, Mr. Sukedu wants to perform it on the beach live. You guys need to contact him ASAP.
And if they can pull it off in India,
yeah,
then I won't even charge them for the party, because we have to shut the parties at 10 p.m. So I don't know how many people are going to go take that risk, but I'm still,
yeah,
saying it, that if they do a party on the beach like,
yeah,
that, then I'm there for you to perform, no problem.
Great. Coming back to what you mentioned previously, since you said that you had a formal training in tabla,
right,
so have you ever had a formal training in DJing?
Well, not in the initial stages. When I began, I had no training in DJing at all. Whatever I learned was actually by watching other DJs, observing them, seeing what they're doing and trying to pick it up, because at that time there was no internet and nothing which you could actually, you know, go down and get onto YouTube and how to become a DJ and bang, you get about 1000 hits, you know, I mean,
yeah,
pages,
yeah,
to go to,
right,
but nothing like that was there.
Yeah.
So it was basically just self-learning,
yeah,
which was very good,
yeah,
because we learned it the wrong way,
yeah,
and then we made it right.
Okay.
So that's why the basics are really strong right now.
Yeah.
So there was no formal training, but after I won my first round of the competition,
yeah,
I didn't win in India.
Okay.
I came second runner-up in India,
okay,
in 1989. So when 1988,
okay,
and then 99, when the competition was going to happen again, I decided that I want to win it this time, no matter what.
Wow.
So then I went to London,
yeah,
for a 7 days crash course at the DMC in Burnham.
Okay.
And I actually did a course, and they especially did the course for me for 7 days,
wow,
which was a 3 month long course. I was doing the course for actually 8 hours a day.
Wow.
So that's the only formal training which I had.
Okay.
And when I came back,
yeah,
I heard about this DJ in Bombay who was probably, I would say, one of the first DJs in India.
Right.
Joe Azaredo.
Okay.
So I wanted to get his point of view on things, because he did make DJing popular in India at that time.
Right.
So I even took a class with him. So the formal training happened after I had already learned.
Okay.
So, yeah.
You know, when it comes to the younger generation, mm-hmm, and people who are planning to take up DJing as a career, what would be your suggestion to them?
I think it's a fantastic idea that youngsters want to become DJs in India, because at the time when we began, nobody,
yeah,
wanted to become a DJ, because it was just a thing like, are you crazy? You can't be out at nights and, you know, in the wrong environments and drinking and smoking and etc. and whatever other, you know, bad stuff goes with it.
Yeah.
But it's good that right now people are actually, you know, telling their kids to take up an alternative career.
Right.
So it's a good thing, because in the future anyways, creativity is something which is going to last. Otherwise everything is going to be either on computer or artificial intelligence or whatever. So if you're creative, which is music,
yeah,
you are going to be doing something nice.
Yeah.
So I think it's really great, because the DJ industry in India is,
yeah,
just beginning.
Yeah.
It is literally just beginning.
Okay.
It's been the last 5 years that it's seen a boom,
yeah,
and it's got a long way to go yet. So once, you know, it becomes bigger, the,
yeah,
money, the market,
yeah,
everything is going to become way bigger. So if you're thinking of becoming a DJ right now,
yeah,
you're in the right profession.
What is the biggest risk in your life that you've taken so far, right?
So coming back to it, my father is a businessman and,
right,
he's a Gujarati and I'm a Gujarati, so we normally don't take very heavy risks,
yeah,
we plan everything.
Yeah.
So while doing my DJing and,
yeah,
pursuing my career,
yeah,
I did my MBA all the way,
yeah,
because I just thought that if I don't make it in this profession, at least my MBA degree, will,
yeah,
you know, I could fall back on it and take up a job, because,
yeah,
at the end of the day, I do have to live my life.
Right.
So that's the thing. But I think one of the biggest risks which I have taken, or maybe I think it's a risk, is that when all the youngsters are just going behind EDM, 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 and sunburn, supersonic, this,
yeah,
artist, that artist coming in, and I've still not deviated from my for, say, that is Bollywood and Bollywood remixes and playing Bollywood music.
Right.
Where a lot of other DJs have actually thought that, oh, let me start playing that music because the youngsters are really liking that.
Right.
Well, my thinking would be that let the youngsters listen to what they want.
Yeah.
But if I could incorporate those sounds in Bollywood music, maybe the youngsters would even like that.
Yeah, totally.
So far it's served me pretty well. So I think that's one of the things that I did not try to change my genre of music of playing and interest. I just stuck by it and try to excel in it in a different way.
Yeah. What would your biggest fear be?
My biggest fear in life has always been that I hope I don't start listening or hearing less. In my whole career, I've always been very afraid of that.
Yeah.
But other than that, being a physical fear,
yeah.
I think one of the biggest fears I always have, and that's why maybe I even try to keep myself very fit, is that no matter how old I get, I want to be standing next to the guy who's half my age and play the music as well, jump around and dance around as much as him or her.
Yeah.
And people should actually think that, has this guy been DJing since 25 years? He doesn't look it, because he looks 25.
Yeah.
So I think that's been one of my biggest fears, that, you know, the youngsters coming in are so intuitive, their inspiration, their creativity, and I know a lot of the boys who work with me, a lot of the programmers and engineers who work with me are half my age, and they are just unbelievable in terms of technology, in terms of thinking, in terms of direction, and I know that I probably did not have that when I was their age.
Yeah.
So I think one of the biggest fears is that I hope I don't become obsolete, so I just try to keep myself continuously updated with everything that happens in the profession.
Well, that's great. One has to, I do completely believe in that you have to constantly reinvent yourself to grow in life.
Yeah.
I was researching about you yesterday, the other day, and you know, I came across this thing that you have started on your Facebook page and on your YouTube channel. You are teaching the younger generation, the people who are willing to learn, who want to learn music, you're teaching them.
Yes.
So how did that happen?
So the thing is that at a certain point in my time, I would say between the years of 2005 to 2010, I was invited to be a judge for a lot of college War of the DJs festivals, that the inter-college festivals like Malhar or Umang or something like that. Not only in Mumbai, but even around in India, so maybe Delhi, Calcutta, etc.
Yeah.
And I noticed that the kids did not know anything about DJing, and it just hurt me.
Yeah.
They just thought it was taking two songs, no matter what genre, and just playing them one after the other, and it was noise.
Yeah.
So I thought that instead of them understanding at a later age that what they want to do, I thought maybe if I open my own institute as well as start a YouTube channel where I can teach them DJing step by step in short 4.5-5 minutes episodes, and you know, get that going, because then at least they'll know the right way of doing things. So tomorrow when they go out and even take part in as small as a maybe college competition, they're at least doing something nice. So whoever the judges at that time doesn't go through the same fate that I went through of just actually saying, what the hell is this guy doing?
Yeah.
So it was more of sort of, let's just give back what I learned in a difficult way.
Yeah.
You know, let them learn it the easier way.
Yeah.
This could probably even take the Indian DJs to a bigger international level.
All right. I would like to end our session with a rapid fire round, and I'd be asking you a couple of questions, and I hope we get all the answers.
I hope so too. Is there a pass button or something like that?
No, sir. So, ready? Brace yourself. Okay, so top 5 tracks on your playlist.
Currently?
Yeah, currently.
I'm going to be Bollywood because I play that.
Definitely.
Definitely, abhi to party shuru hui hai. Let's Nacho, Chalti Hai 9 Se 12, Mercy, and the fifth track I can't think of.
No worries, I think we'll be, all our viewers will be good with four. Yeah. Who are your top 3 favorite artists?
Indian, international.
Overall.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
So number 1 on the list is Deadmau5 always. Number 2 on the list is this DJ called Spencer Brown, who I already mentioned, is one of my favorites. And another third guy who's really coming up and doing very good music right now is Cyrus Hood.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any crazy incident that you've ever...
So, I won't say it's a crazy incident, but it was a really exciting incident that I have a habit of whenever I'm playing a particular part of a track, which is like the key part of the track, and I know the crowd is going to dance, sing along on that particular part.
Yeah.
So, for example, if you're playing Let Me Love You, then you're going to give up, and the crowd loves to sing that, So, I normally like to put the volume down and let the crowd sing and then put it back up.
Yeah.
And I was playing at an event, I think, not mistaken, in Jaipur or Udaipur, I can't recollect.
Yeah.
And it was an open air thing, and of course, things were running on a generator.
Yeah.
So, the music was playing and I think this particular track was playing and I had done it the first time so the crowd assumed that I'm going to do it the second time the generator went off and the volumes went off and the crowd was still singing na 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 let me and they went on and on and on and I had no idea what was happening so I was just wondering what to do and what happened and the generators got back on and the crowd thought that it was something that I did which was very you know nice and amusing and I wanted them to sing and then the volume goes up so mess which got covered up really well so I think that's something which is exciting that happened and has happened before in my life as well.
Nice. My next question would be if you had the power to erase and abolish one genre which would it be and why?
Okay, so this round just this question just puts me into trouble, right? So if I name any genre, then and if you post it up or put it up and if somebody says, oh, he doesn't like my music. I'm not actually against any genre at all.
Okay.
Very frankly speaking, I'm okay with everything.
Yeah.
In fact, the more the genres, the better it is because we get to explore and listen to different types of music.
Right.
So really wouldn't like anything which I say, oh, remove this.
Okay. So my last question would be, which is your favorite button on your console? Like the one which you press the most?
Well, there's a button on the console, on the digital turntables which I use, which is called the hot cues.
Okay.
That is the button which I use the most. So if that's not there or not working on any console, I'm just like, listen, you got to change these players.
Yeah.
I need that button going on. So yeah, the hot cue button.
Wow. So that was a rapid fire round. Thank you very much, Saketu. Thank you for being a part of the show.
On Coffee with Karan, when somebody does well in a rapid fire, they get
they get a coffee hamper.
Yeah. Do I get anything?
I'll have to talk to my producers about that. I don't have that.
Just kidding.
Right. So thank you very much. Thank you for coming on the show. Thank you for talking with us. And I'm sure our viewers would love to see you again sometime. Let's see.
No, but I'm sure all the girls watching this video out there, next time be prepared. He's all set for that.
All the girls who are watching that and they do like me, then you know, like they mentioned that please comment, subscribe and so comment and say that you like me. I would love that.
Everyone loves to hear we love you. Yes.